We're gonna do a little work in the garage today, not on the 2011 Impala, but we're gonna work on the 2012 Civic. All right, so what we're gonna do is change both the high pressure filter and the low pressure CNG filter and show you exactly what you need to do. So the first thing that you do is to jack it up in the rear, get plenty of clearance in the back, and then you're ready to start it up. So I've got service due now, B13. Don't miss it, work till 5 today, and tomorrow from noon to 5, so under the driver's side rear wheel. All right. Under the driver's side, by the rear wheel, you got a shutoff valve. Turn that clockwise, and that will shut off the pressure to the fuel system. And in a few seconds, it'll run out of fuel, and we can start with the high pressure fuel filter, which is in that assembly right there. So I think the manual says to take this cover off, but as you can see, it's easy to access it without removing the cover. So we'll do it two different ways. We'll do it with a crescent wrench, and then we'll do it with this socket tool that fits right over the end of the filter canister housing piece there, and it comes right off really quick with that. But we'll show you the difference. It takes just a few seconds and the car will die, and I'll go shut the key off. Alright, so here we go, trying to get the crescent wrench figured out here. Alright, so yeah, it's hard to hold both things at the same time. So you get it on there. And that's how you get it. So, broke it loose. All right, let's compare how it would be with the other tool. I'll put that back on. And then we'll get the socket tool and make sure we're going the right direction. All right, so the socket tool, we'll just rotate it till it fits on there. And then boom, it's like super easy. The socket is way better. All right, so the way I do it, I don't ever remove the screw out of the back of this one because I know I'm gonna take it off and change it, because this one's so easy to get to and it's so robust, it's not gonna tear up like the low pressure one. So that's a problem. This one is ready to be changed for sure. All right, well, that was good. Okay, well, let's look at the high pressure filter now that we've got it out. So the housing on the high pressure is very
robust and it's thick stainless steel. We've got an O-ring at the top that appears that it's kind of expanded since we took it off. It's not wanting to go back in the groove. But anyway, the kit comes with a new one. So we can see there's some compressor oil that ends up collecting in the bottom. So we'll clean all that out. This is the original filter. Looked like it was ready to be changed. All right, that one was made in January of 2015. Then the new one here was made in August of 2016, but it was brand new. It comes the part number 16905-S1G-003. That kit contains the filter and two O-rings. So this large one is the O-ring for the top. And see, it fits perfectly in there. That don't sit up there very good. All right, so it sits perfectly in there compared to the old one that kind of expanded a little bit. It's a little bit too big. So anyway, we'll use the new O-ring. And the other O-ring that comes in the kit is for the drain plug. So we'll go ahead and change that out. Since we got a new O-ring, we'll go ahead and change it out, I guess. The other thing that I wanted to highlight is the difference between using the crescent wrench and the tool that we've got here. So this is from C&G Consulting, and it's a tool that's specially made for this application and this application only. So it works on the Honda Civics. So as you can see, it fits in there perfect. Allows you to get your half inch drive ratchet on there and get a good bite on that bottom section of the housing, and goes in there perfect. So the other way to do it, like we were shown before, is to use the crescent wrench, and you can see how it slips, and you know, it's just not a very good deal. So the socket works really well. So what we'll do now, we'll get a rag and we'll finish cleaning out all the oil out of here. We'll take the drain plug off, we'll put the new O-ring on it, we'll clean it all up, then we'll get ready for reassembly. All right, so I've got this all cleaned up. I cleaned the O-ring and I cleaned the O-ring groove, squirted some brake clean down in there, used the brake parts cleaner, cleaned all the oil, the residue out of there. It's all cleaned up. Got the new O-ring on there. And then what we're going to do is use some of this Honda silicone grease. It's that part number 08798-9013. And it's this silicone grease. It's a pretty large tube. It'll last you forever, I imagine. So I'm just using a little bit, and that's way too much actually. So I'm just gonna put a little bit around this O-ring. Just to make sure that it doesn't bind up when it's being installed and screwed on there. So that's it. So we're ready to go. Put the new filter on, then put the housing on and torque it down. We'll be ready to go to the low pressure fit, housing and try to deal with that one. That one's not near as easy as this one. I wish that they were both the same kind of housing, but we've got a aftermarket solution for that. The factory Honda part is pretty poor design, so we'll look at that here in just a minute. All right, here we go. Ready to install the new filter. We've got the brand new filter here. It just slips onto the tube there, and that holds it in. That rubber end holds it on there real good. Then we put the housing on. There we go. I'll use the tool and torque it down, and that's it. We're ready to go to the low pressure side. All right, so we let the back down, we jack the front up, and first thing we've got to do is remove this metal cover. So what I use for that's my cordless drill with a Phillips bit in it, and we'll remove that and we'll see. Oh, and yeah, I think that's all we need is Phillips. It's got four screws in it, I believe. So we'll take that out and be right back. Okay, so I've removed the metal pan that was in the middle. That's all you need to take off when you change the oil, but we still can't quite get to where we need to. There's the low pressure fuel filter housing right there. So we probably need to take the rest of this plastic off. So we'll use a regular flat bladed screwdriver and a 10 millimeter socket to get the rest of this plastic off. All right, so we've got the other plastic cover off the underneath side of the car, so we can see the low pressure housing and the part that we need to get on there to get that off. So what I'm going to use is my half inch ratchet with a couple of extensions on there. So I'm looking at, you know, pretty close to 19 inches worth of extensions. And then I've got a universal joint on there. And then I've got the 24 millimeter socket. So we've got the 12 point. We'll see how that works. This is the setup that was recommended so that we can get up in there and get the ratchet down below the frame so that we can have some swing on it. So we'll try that. There's no way I'm gonna be able to hold the camera and do the ratchet at the same time, so we're not going to be able to show it exactly, but I'll get under there and show you where to connect the socket onto the housing. All right, so here we are underneath the car in the front, in between the engine and the firewall. We've got this low pressure housing, so it's pretty easy to spot. It's got a big hex nut on the bottom of the housing. It's right by the back side of the engine. So this is the nut that we're going to get on with that assembly that I just showed you, and we'll see how that works. So we've got to just break this free
and we'll show you the reason that this housing's a problem whenever we get it off, and we'll show you how flimsy it is. All right.
Okay, so I ended up having to use a breaker bar because this thing is so tight and so hard to get off. But anyway, I've got the ratchet on there now to finish it off, but you can see how the extensions stack up so that you can get past that frame and get down here to get some leverage on it. But this thing is so tight, and it bends. You can see how it's kind of bent up and messed up because there's so much torque that needs to be applied to get this thing off. So anyway, the bracket that holds the pressure regulator assembly and this filter unit, it kind of flexed and possibly might have deformed a little bit and bent, but it's okay. It doesn't cause any trouble with your fuel lines or anything. It doesn't bend that much, but it does move around when you put that much torque on it. So anyway, this is how you get on it, and oh, there she goes. It had a little bit of pressure on it. It kind of popped when it come off. So we'll get it down and take a look at it. Okay, now we've got the low pressure filter out, and it really looks clean, but you can't hardly see, but there is oil in the bottom there. Even though it looks good on the outside, it's oil soaked on the inside. And we can see here we've got quite a bit of compressor oil. Yeah, pretty good amount. All right, so the problem with the factory housing on the low pressure filter is that it's so fragile. You can see when you look at the profile of it how deformed the end of it got just from trying to undo it. The amount of torque that you have to put on there to get it off, it just can't handle it, and it bends. And you can, even when I took it to the Honda dealership and I looked at it after they got through doing it, I noticed that it looked like that they had bent it and then somehow, you know, bent it back to make it look like it wasn't deformed like this. But you could tell it had some damage around this bottom of it. So anyway, this, I believe it's the third time that I've taken this unit off. And, well, maybe fourth time. I think I did it once, and then I had the Honda dealership do it twice. So this is the fourth time that this one's been off, and it's pretty much ruined. So what we are going to replace it with is this unit from C&G Consulting, and it is a superior, way more robust design. So it's machined out of aluminum, and it's thick and sturdy. It's got the same kind of a hex nut setup and an easy way to get on it when you're underneath there trying to put it on, take it off. But an advantage that the new one has over the old one, like the high pressure one, had a way to drain that oil out of there so that you could get all this oil out without having to change the filter. The factory one doesn't have a way to do that. So you can see you have to try to take it off and bend it up every time you want to drain that out. But the new and improved design, it has a drain built in so that there's potential for doing a maintenance in between changing the filter so that you can just do the oil draining and not have to mess with taking the whole thing off and changing the filter. So I need to, this has been sitting around in my garage for a little while. I need to clean that out before I put it on. And I'm going to put some more of the Honda silicone grease on the threads. You can see this one came with some pre-applied on there. I'll probably clean that off since it's been sitting out here in my garage, and apply a liberal amount. I'm going to put it all over the threads and where the O-rings sit, and also on the O-rings themselves. So this one has got two different O-rings. This one is more of a dust seal than an O-ring. So this one can be reused and put onto the new housing. This one that's right here in this groove, that one is the one that comes in the new kit. So with the Honda part number 16905-RNE-A00, you get the new big O-ring and the new filter. So we'll put those on, and we'll reuse that dust seal, because that's all it is. It's just a seal here for that flange on the housing, just to keep dust from getting up in there. So there's no, it's not a pressure containing seal. No problem there reusing it, but I wouldn't reuse any of the pressure containing seals. Replace those every time. So this drain plug, it has the same O-ring seal as the other drain plug on the back, so you can reuse those if you got an extra one of those. Or you can just go to your local O-ring supply center, like a industrial supply, seal supply. And I've always been getting the Viton, even though those are really made for more high temperature. It's really not needed for this application, but some of the ones from Parker come as a Viton seal for their CNG housing. So I've been buying the Viton O-rings whenever I need to just buy an O-ring by itself. You can get them for like less than a dollar at the industrial seal supply company versus, you know, who knows how much, you know, Honda probably wants $4 or $5 for that little O-ring. You can just go down there and get it for 50 cents. So we'll go back with this housing and put that one back on there, and it will be far superior. It, you know, won't collapse like this one. It's super sturdy, really great machining and finish on this, and I'm excited about getting that one put on. So I'll get it put on there and we'll show you what it looks like. All right, so what I'm going to do now is prep the new aluminum housing that CNG Consulting has manufactured to replace the OEM Honda housing, which is the junky one that crumpled up when you remove it. So in order to not have to put that back on, we're going to replace it with the new aluminum unit. So what I did to prep it is I cleaned it out with that brake clean and a towel, got it all sparkling clean inside there. I put a new O-ring and lubricated the O-ring and torqued that down, got that tight, ready to go. And I transferred the dust seal from the original housing over to this new one. It's just a real easy slip-on fit there, and I just cleaned it up and put it on there and didn't do anything else other than I put this tape on there. And the only reason that I have the tape on there is to protect the brand new O-ring as it slid on there. This is the new O-ring that came in the kit with the new filter. It's all clean and ready to go, and if you slide it on without the tape on there, you run the risk of damaging the seal. You know, the O-ring. So what we do here is just roll it over the tape, so there's all the threads are right here underneath there, so we can roll the O-ring down and then figure out where the tape is at. Take the tape off. Now we got our O-ring on there without it being damaged. So we've already got a little bit of that silicone lubricant in there. So it goes in this groove, and that's how it goes in. So there's not much to it. It's pretty simple. All right, so we've got the O-ring on the new housing, and it's in the correct groove, and we've got it pretty cleaned up. So what we're gonna do now is apply some more of this Honda silicone grease and make sure it's all on the threads as well as the O-ring. So I'm just gonna put a little dab ever so often, something like that, and then I am gonna liberally apply this all over the threads and the O-ring. This is not gonna hurt it having too much, and it could actually help us to be able to get the thing off next time if we have plenty of this on there to ensure that it doesn't seize up on there and cause any troubles. So that's what we got. We're ready to go. So I guess what I'm going to do now is put it in the freezer, and that will contract that O-ring a little bit, make it a little easier to install onto the pressure regulator assembly there. So the purpose of shrinking that O-ring is to make sure that it doesn't try to jump out of that groove as you're pushing it on. So the biggest problem that I ran into originally is that these threads are very fine threads, and I didn't want to cross thread it when I was doing it on this original one. So I made the mistake of constantly trying to rotate it as I pushed it on to the pressure regulator. So I was rotating as I pushed because I wanted to start the threads, and I was being real careful, and but I was constantly rotating. And it took me a long time to figure out that this O-ring has to actually push past the sealing surface where it mates on before the threads will engage. So if you rotate before you start, or as you're pushing it, it'll make this O-ring pucker up every time, and it makes it where it feels like it's engaged and it feels like you're starting the threads, but it'll pop right off. It won't be on there. So the trick is to not rotate, but to push. It's like an eighth of an inch, just a little bit of a push. Once you get it squared up on the housing, you make sure that you're square. You kind of feel like this. Feel around, make sure you're squared up, and then just push it, boom, about that much, and then you can start rotating. And then the threads will engage. But if you don't do that little push at the beginning, it's just a bear to try to get it to start. So anyway, that's my trick that I always used after I'd messed up that first time, is to make sure I push it a little bit before I start turning. So I've never tried the shrink it in the freezer trick. I'm gonna go ahead and do that this time just to see if it does make it any easier. But if you push it before you start turning it, it'll work a lot better. So we'll go ahead and try it just to make it that much easier, and we'll show you how that goes here in just a second. All right, here's what it looks like without the filter element in there and without the housing on it. So we are ready for the new filter to go in there. So it's gonna be hard to hold the camera at this position right here while I do that. So let me just slip it onto that tube, and then we'll resume the camera after I do that. All right, so now
I've pushed the new filter up onto the tube. It was a little tougher to push on there than the high pressure element, but it just goes right up in there and slides right up in there. I pushed it until it bottomed out, and that's all you need to do with that. So we're still waiting on the housing piece, the canister part, to get cold in the freezer. We're gonna leave that in there for about 20 to 25 minutes, and then we'll put it right on. Okay, here's a view from further out. We're underneath the frame here, so the other shot, I was way up in there, real close to it. So from this angle, you can see the surrounding components there for the pressure regulator assembly, and how that looks from a little further back, where you can see what's all around it. Okay, so one thing I noticed while I was waiting on the housing to chill in the freezer was that I've made the pressure regulator mounting bracket come loose from the, it's kind of a vibration isolation mount. It's a bolt with a washer, and there's two rubber grommets in there that allow it to vibrate. The other one up here at the top, it was out, and I was able to push it back in. This lower one, I'm gonna try to just grab a hold of this bracket and move it and slide it back into that, in between the two grommets. If that doesn't work, I'll try to take the bolt out, reposition it, and then put the bolt back in. So these things just slip right off. You can see how it's kind of a C-shaped slot there in the bracket. So it should just go right back down in there. So I was kind of hesitant to try to realign that before I torqued on it again, but I'm not gonna put very much pressure on it to assemble it. So I think I'm gonna go ahead and straighten it up now, and then it'll be ready to go when we get the housing out of the freezer. Okay, so it's a little bit of a process here to get this bracket to realign where it needs to go. I ended up taking the bolt out, slipping the grommet onto the bracket. I thought that I might be able to use some channel lock pliers to move it into position, but it just wouldn't. I could move it down, but I needed to push it towards the firewall at the same time, and I couldn't do both. So I took the bolt out. So now it's kind of a multi-step process here. I'm gonna have to use a pry bar stuck up onto the top of the bracket to pry it down, and then start the bolt in once I get it down in position, and then just tighten the bolt back up. It'll be as good as new and ready to go for that new filter housing. Okay, so what it is, I used a pry bar to push down on that bracket while I used a socket and an extension that's a 10 millimeter to get the bolt started. So the way that I've got this pry bar up in there, it's kind of using leverage up against this electrical connection bracket to be able to put some force on it and get it to where I could bend it down and get it started. So that worked. You can see how it moves there. So it's in the grommet now, and it is, the bolt's in. So all I need to do is tighten that back up and we'll be ready to go. The other end is still engaged in there, no problem. So we'll be good to go. Okay, here we go. It's right in here by the steak, the roast. right, so it was actually in there for longer than 25 minutes because I ended up eating my dinner while I was freezing that. One thing that I forgot to mention is that the original housing has a 24 millimeter hex on it. This one's got a 30 millimeter. So we got to use a different socket for this one. So we're going to go stick it on there. And like I said, we got to push it first and then turn it after it's already went past the ceiling surface. The O-ring's got to be seated before you start turning. So we're going to stick it on there and see how it goes. Okay, well, I got it on. One thing, I wish I could have held the camera and done this, try to install the housing on there at the same time. Because with the light, the way I've got it, I could see exactly what was happening to that O-ring. If you didn't get it exactly squared up, then it was pushing it out of the groove, and it was puckering up and coming out where you couldn't push it on up in there. So the way that I fixed that was just rotating, you know, just kind of squaring it up. I backed out, squared up, and pushed at different angles. It's kind of hard to feel when you get it perfectly square, but that's where you have to have it. You have to have it, you know, hitting all around 100% of the circumference there of the O-ring, and then you push it till it slips on past that ceiling surface, and then you can rotate it. So right now that's where we're at. I've got it pushed up on there, and I can get on it with this 30 millimeter socket, if I can do that with one hand. So there we go. We can get this tightened up, and it's only supposed to be at 20 foot-pounds, so that is almost hand tight. So I'm, even though I've got a half inch ratchet on here, I'm only holding on to the head of it. So I'm doing it with real low leverage so that I don't over torque it. I'm just going to do it like this. With, I'm not going to get on the end of the handle, and that way I don't run the risk of over torquing, because all my torque wrenches are a 3/8 drive, and all I've got for that 30 millimeter is this half inch. So, and I don't have an adapter, so I'm just gonna do it as light as I can and make sure that it's tight, and we'll just go with it like that. So we'll be able to start it up just here in a few minutes and make sure that it doesn't leak. So we're almost there. Yep, see how we're flexing everything now. So we're getting close. So it's just need to make sure I snug it up, and we'll be ready to fire it off. All right, so I just have to reach down under here by the rear wheel on the driver's side, and I can feel that valve, the shutoff valve. So we rotate it counterclockwise, and that activates this fuel system again. So now we've got pressure, and we can start it up. So that's good. So everything is good.
right, so we're done with the fuel filter change project today here in the garage. We appreciate you staying tuned for the full duration. I didn't realize it was going to be such a long video, but anyway, it is a pretty time-consuming job to do all that. So now we've got new CNG filters for the high pressure and the low pressure, and we're good to go on that, so we can reset the maintenance minder. I was thinking about one thing that you might have caught a glimpse of in the video is that I've got the home fill unit, and it's a pretty neat device, and I probably need to do a whole video dedicated to the operation and how that thing is so beneficial here in our garage. We use it pretty much, if not every day, we use it every other day. Since we have three CNG vehicles, we got two of the Civics and one Impala that's been converted to a dedicated CNG system. So we will do that on a future video. Thanks again for watching. We'll catch you next time.